Well, now, when the time came that you qualified as a doctor, what made you decide to specialize in being an alienist?
Yeah, that is rather an interesting point. When I had finished my studies practically, and when I didn't know what I really wanted to do, I had a big chance to follow one of my professors. He was called to a new position in Munich, and he wanted me as his assistant. But then, in that moment, I studied for my final examination. I came across the textbook, a textbook of psychiatry. Up to then, I thought nothing about it, because our professor then wasn't particularly interesting. And I only read the introduction to that book, where certain things were said about psychosis as a maladjustment of the personality. That hit the nail on the head. In that moment, I saw I must become an alienist. My heart was thumping wildly in that moment. When I told my professor I wouldn't follow him, I would study psychiatry, he couldn't understand it. Nor my friends, because in those days psychiatry was nothing at all. But I saw one great chance to unite certain contrasting things in myself, namely, beside medicine, beside natural science, I always had studied history of philosophy and such subjects. It was just as if suddenly two streams were joining.
And how long was it after you took that decision that you first came in contact with Freud?
Oh, you know, that was at the end of my studies, and then it took quite a while until I met Freud. You see, I finished my studies in 1900, and I met Freud only very much later. In 1900, I already read his dream interpretation and the boy of Freud studies about hysteria, but that was merely literary, you know. And then in 1907, I became acquainted with him personally.
Will you tell me how that happened? Did you go to Vienna?
Oh, well, I'd written a book about the psychology of dementia praecox, that was called Schizophrenia then. I sent him that book, and thus became acquainted. I went to Vienna for a fortnight then, and then we had a very long and penetrating conversations, and that settled it.
And this long and penetrating conversation was followed by a personal friendship?
Oh yes, it soon developed into a personal friendship.
And what sort of man was Freud?
Well, he was a complicated nature, you know. I liked him very much, but I soon discovered that when he had thought something, then it was settled, while I was doubting all along the line. And it was impossible to discuss something really a fond. You know, he had no philosophical education, particularly, I was studying Kant, and I was steeped in it, and that was far from Freud. So, from the very beginning, there was a discrepancy.
Did you, in fact, grow apart later, partly because of a difference in temperamental approach to experiment and proof and so on?
Well, of course, there is always a temperamental difference. His approach was naturally different from mine, because his personality was different from mine. That led me into my later investigation of psychological types. There are definite attitudes. Some people are doing it in this way and other people are doing it in the other typical way. And there were such differences between myself and Freud too.
Do you consider that Freud's standard of proof and experimentation was less high than your own?
Well, that is an evaluation I'm not competent of. I am not my own history or my historiographer. In with reference to certain results, I think my method has its merits.
Tell me, did Freud himself ever analyze you?
Yes, I had submitted quite a lot of my dreams to him, and so did he.
And he to you? Yes.
Oh yes. Yes. Yes.
Do you remember now, at this distance of time, what were the significant features of Freud's dreams that you noted at the time?
Well, that is rather indiscreet to ask. You know, there is such a thing as a professional secret.
He's been dead these many years.
These regards last longer than life. I prefer not to talk about it.
Well, may I ask you something else then, which perhaps is also indiscreet. Is it true that you have a very large number of letters which you exchanged with Freud, which are still unpublished?
Yes.
When are they going to be published?
Well, not during my lifetime.
You would have no objection to them being published after your lifetime?
Oh, no, not at all.
Because they are probably of great historical importance.
I don't think so.
Then why have you not published them so far?
Because they were not important to me enough. I see no particular importance in them.
They are concerned with personal matters?
Well, partially. But I wouldn't care to publish them.
Well now, can we move on to the time when you did eventually part company with Freud? It was partly, I think, with the publication of your book, The Psychology of the Unconscious. Is that correct?
That was the real cause.
Well now, before you...
Oh, I mean the final cause, because it had a long preparation. You know, from the beginning I had a reservatio mentalis. I couldn't agree with quite a number of his ideas.
Which ones in particular?
Well, chiefly his purely personal approach and his disregard of the historical conditions of man. You see, we depend largely upon our history. We are shaped through education, through the influence of the parents, which are by no means always personal. They were prejudiced or they were influenced by historical ideas or what I call dominance. And that is a most decisive factor in psychology. And we are not of today or of yesterday. We are of an immense age.
Was it not partly your observation, your clinical observation of psychotic cases, which led you to differ from Freud on this?
It was partially my experience with schizophrenic patients that led me to the idea of certain general historical conditions.
Is there any one case that you can now look back on and feel that perhaps it was the turning point of your thought?
Oh, yes. I made quite a number of experiences of that sort, and I went even to Washington to study Negroes at the psychiatric clinic there in order to find out whether they have the same type of dreams as we have. These experiences and others led me then to the hypothesis that there is an impersonal stratum in our psyche. And I can tell you an example. We had a patient in the ward. He was quiet but completely dissociated, schizophrenic. And he was in the clinic already for over 20 years. He had come into the clinic as a matter of fact of being a young man, a little clerk, and did no particular education. And once I came into the ward, and he was obviously excited and called to me, took me by the lapel of my coat and led me to the window and said, "Doctor, now you must see. Now look at it. Look up at the sun and see how it moves. See, you must move your head too like this, and then you will see the follows of the sun. And you know, that's the origin of the wind. And you see how the sun moves as you move your head from one side to the other." Now, of course, I didn't understand it at all. I thought, there you are, he's just crazy. But that case remained in my mind. And 4 years later, I came across a paper written by the German historian Dietrich, who had dealt with the so-called Mithras liturgy, a part of the great Parisian sorcerer papyrus. And there he produced the a part of the so-called Mithras liturgy. Namely, it is said there, "After the second prayer, thou wilt see how the disk of the sun unfolds. And you will see hanging down from it the tube, the origin of the wind. And when you move thy face to the regions of the east, it will move there. And if you move your face to the region of the west, it will follow you." And instantly, I knew, now this is it. This is the vision of my patient.
But how could you be sure that your patient wasn't unconsciously recalling something that somebody had told him?
Oh, no, quite out of question, because that thing was not known. It was in a magic papyrus in Paris, and it wasn't even published. It was only published 4 years later after I had observed it with my patient.
And this, you felt, proved that there was an unconscious, which was something more than personal.
Oh, well, that was not a proof to me, but it was a hint. And I took the hint.